But we had prayer in school every morning. Government began with prayer. Civic clubs began with prayer. God was a part of our society, and now we're losing that heritage. And people are saying, what's happening in America? We have lost the heritage that we've had with God, and it's time for America to come back to an old-fashioned altar and say, God, heal our land and bring us home again. Turn with us to Daniel chapter 3. We want to speak to you this morning on the topic, faith in the fire. Faith in the fire. Beginning in Daniel chapter 3, verse 14. Nebuchadnezzar spake and said unto them, is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Do you not serve my gods, nor worship the golden image which I have set up? Now, if you are ready, that at what time you hear the sound of the cornet, the flute, the harp, sackbut, psaltery, dulcimer, and all the kinds of music, you fall down and worship the image which I have made, well. But if you worship not, you shall be cast the same hour into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. And who is that God that shall deliver you out of my hands? He shouldn't have asked that. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful to answer thee in this matter. If it be so, our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king. But if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. Then was Nebuchadnezzar full of fury, and the form of his visage was changed against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Therefore he spake and commanded that they should heat the furnace 7 times more than it was wont or normal to be heated. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. Speak to us this morning. Holy Spirit, we give you room. And we release every word to you. We place it in your hands. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This story has good news and bad news. The bad news is that those who take a stand for God will be tried by fire. But the good news is when you walk through the fire won't burn you. When you walk through the flood, the waters won't drown you. When you go in the lion's den, the lions cannot eat you, because the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is able to deliver his people. Amen. Praise the Lord. The Lord will deliver the righteous in the day of trouble. Those who take a stand will go through the fire. But I want to tell you, cowards are never challenged. The complacent and the content are never challenged. God doesn't write the names of all the people who bowed down, does he? Whose name got recorded? The names of those who refused to bow, and they stood up and they changed a nation and they changed their lives because they refused to bow down. I want to tell you, It's time for God's people to take a stand. Well, first this morning, the first question is, are you bowing or standing? Are you bowing or standing? There are two kinds of people in this story. There are two kinds of people in this auditorium and listening to me by television. You're either bowing or you're standing. You're either bowing to the gods of this world, the gods of money and greed and materialism, secular humanism, New Age thoughts and theories. You're either bowing to them or you're standing for the living God and you're saying, I will not bow down or compromise with the gods of this world. You're either standing for God. Where are you in this picture? You saved or lost, sheep or goats, wheat or tares? Are you standing for God, or are you compromising, blending in, trying not to rock the boat, not to create too many waves, to be politically correct so you won't stand out from everybody else? You see, the day and time has come when God's people have got to take a stand, and they've got to say, I stand for the Word of God. I believe that God is my deliverer and my helper and my redeemer. It's time. Society is beyond the moment when we can sit idly by. We need to take a stand today. Amen. Well, the Bible says, you cannot serve two masters. I believe it was James that said that a friend of the world is an enemy of God. You see, your life is not limited by where you are. Well, Pastor, if I was somewhere else, things would be different. If this was here, it would be different. If I was not a captive in Babylon, if I was back home in Jerusalem, everything would be different, but I can't help it. We're here, we just got to go along. And, you know, when you're in Rome, do like the Romans do. You know, no, that's not the thing. Your life is not limited by where you are. It's only limited by what you are. Your life is limited by your character and by what's in you and what's living in you. Revelations chapter 21 and verse 8. In that verse, he says, the fearful. Who are the fearful? Who are the fearful? The afraid? Those who don't want to rock the boat? Those who don't want to take a stand? Those who don't want to stand out? The fearful shall have their place in the lake of fire, which burneth with fire and brimstone. Folks, I don't want to be numbered among the fearful and the afraid and the cowardly and the reticent. I want to take a stand for God. I want to take a stand for God. We need men and women. We need young people more than ever who will take a stand among their peers and at their school and say, I believe God, and I'm going to live for God, and I'm going to put God first in my life. It's time to take a stand. America is engaged in a great battle. It's a cultural war, a spiritual war, light versus darkness, truth versus deception, Christ versus the spirit of Antichrist. There's going to be a winner and a loser. Folks, there is. And the prize is the future of America and your children and your grandchildren. That is the prize. And we're going to determine the direction of America. We were talking, I was visiting with some folks this week, and one of the gentlemen said, you know, I don't think we'll ever see the America that you and I grew up in again. We talked about how the neighborhood I grew up in, when I was able in the first grade to walk to school, not all by myself, there were lots of other kids in the neighborhood, and we all walked blocks to school. All the kids did. You know, back then, some people didn't even lock their doors. We never worried about kidnappings and things like that, but we had prayer in school every morning. Government began with prayer. Civic clubs began with prayer. God was a part of our society, and now we're losing that heritage. And people are saying, what's happening in America? We have lost the heritage that we've had with God, and it's time for America to come back to an old-fashioned altar and say, God, heal our land and bring us home again. Amen. David said it this way, is there not a cause? Is there not a cause? When he looked at the fearful Israeli army and he saw Goliath and he looked around, he said, is there not a cause? Folks, I want to ask you the same question today. Is there not a cause in America today that we need to take a stand for? It's time to take a stand, secondly, for America. It's a sad day in America when a federal judge issues an order that no one at a high school graduation can mention the name of Jesus, or they will rue the day they were born. That's a sad day. When a child is suspended from grammar school because she wrote a paper entitled, Why I Love Jesus. When kids in California in the grammar schools get to select their gender and decide, do you feel like a male or a female? You choose what restroom you want to use and decide how you want to be treated. Folks, it's a sad day in America when they're teaching Heather has two mommies. That's a sad day in America. Folks, there comes a time in America when we need to take a stand, when we need to stand up for the things of God. There comes a moment we're bowing to the gods of this world. We're bowing to socialism. Oh, did you realize that America is being transformed into a socialist state? We're bowing to the gods of socialism, where the state is God, and the state is all-powerful and all-knowing. I heard one of our leaders say the other day, well, you've got to keep in mind that the good of the many overrules the rights of one. And I went, oh no. The framers of the Declaration of Independence said that our individual rights don't derive from the state, but they derive from the God who made us and created us. And we have the rights of God. Well, they say, but Pastor, you're just not inclusive. Well, Jesus said, he that is not for me is against me. He said, there's a broad way that leads to destruction, and there's a lot of people on it, and there's a narrow way that leads to life, and few there be that find it. I want to tell you, it's time for us to do like Ephesians chapter 6, verse 13, when we need to look at that, and Paul says, and when you've done all, then put on the whole armor of God, and having done all, then stand and refuse to give up and stand in the evil day. It's time for us to take a stand in the evil day. It's time to stand right now. Believe God for great and mighty things. Wow, I got to hurry. I got to keep leaving stuff out. Time is moving on. There's a time for Christians to take a stand for our values. When the rest of the world is bowing down, when a federal judge strikes down a state constitutional provision against same-sex marriage and says, well, I just want to be on the right side of history. I want to be on God's side. I want to be on God's side. I want to take a stand for the Word of God. Oh, I know it seems like a lot of pressure for teenagers. Peer pressure is the greatest pressure in the world. Peer pressure can seem overwhelming. But God is calling to raise up a generation that will not bow down, but will take a stand for God. And like Joshua can say, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. It's time to take a stand. Persecution will come to you. All who live godly will face persecution. Jesus said, the world hated me, and the world's going to hate you also. The Bible says, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which does beset you. I tell you, the world hates Christ. The world despises him. You remember two or three years ago, Britt Hume, who I believe was on the Fox Channel at that time, I don't know if he is now, he was doing a commentary. I mean, just a casual commentary. And he mentioned the name Jesus. And the network was flooded with protests and calls, and a firestorm erupted because he mentioned the name of Jesus. And Britt Hume said, you know, if I'd said Mohammed, nobody would have said one word. If I'd said Buddha, there wouldn't have been one protest. But because I mentioned the name of Jesus, they cannot stand it. I want to tell you, the powers of darkness hate the name of Jesus, and there is power in that name today. Amen. Praise the Lord. Thirdly, the church is not called to retreat. We are cursed with a casual Christianity. We want comfort, but not challenge. We want a crown, but not a cross. We want the approval of the world, even if it means the disapproval of God. I want to tell you, 2 Timothy, in chapter 2, Paul says, endure hardness as a good soldier of the cross. We're not here to go along to get along. We're not here to hold the fort. We are the mighty marching army of the living God, and we need to be up, and we need to be attacking the gates of hell, and demons should flee before us. Amen. We are the mighty army of God. Fourthly, now the good part. Our God is able to deliver us. Our God is able to deliver us. These young men had been taught the Word of God. They knew the God of Israel. They knew the God that parted the Red Sea, the God that left Pharaoh and his armies face down in the Red Sea, the God that made water spring forth out of the rock, the God that sent manna to feed his people. They knew this God. They knew, and they said, this God, the God that we know, this God is able to deliver us. I want to tell you, this morning, the God that hung the stars in space, the God that put the universe in synchronization, the God that holds the seas in the palm of his hand and says, you can come this far and no more, that God loves you and he's able to deliver you this morning. Amen. I want to tell you the demons of hell may rage and the forces of darkness may rage. Let Nebuchadnezzar make the furnace 7 times hotter. But my God is still able to deliver me from every enemy. Amen. Our God is able. I love that. Our God is able. Say it. Say it. Our God is able. Our God's able. You say, but Pastor, you don't know my condition. Our God's able. Is your condition worse than being thrown into a fiery furnace? I don't think so. They said, our God's able. Paul and Silas sang in the midnight hour when they were beaten and in prison. They sang in the darkness of the dungeon. They sang filled with the dampness all around them. But they sang, when your dreams are broken and crushed, you can lift your eyes and you can say, my God is able to deliver me and set me back up and set me free. Amen. Wow, I'm having to do a summary. Number 5. They didn't just say, our God is able to deliver us. That's what a lot of people say. Our God's able to deliver us. You know what they said? They said, our God whom we serve is able. Oh, we don't want that. Could we delete that phrase, whom we serve? Could we delete that out? They said, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us. Are you serving? Are you serving God? Are you a bystander? Do you cheer? Good luck, God. Hope it works out for you. I mean, are we sitting on a pew just cheering, or do we serve? Do we serve God? God didn't promise to deliver those that don't serve Him. Do you know Christ as personal Savior? Do you have a personal experience with a living Lord who lives in you and is changing you and has made you a new creature in Christ Jesus? Do you attend church faithfully? Do you tithe? Oh no, there's that word. Don't say that, Pastor. Do you tithe? Do you pray? Do you serve in ministry? Are you involved in the kingdom of God? Are you involved? Jesus said, he that is greatest among you shall be your servant. He came to serve. He said, I didn't come to be ministered to, but to minister. Christ was a servant. Where are you serving today? Do you have a place of ministry? I don't have time. I could ask how many people don't have any job right now involved in any job in the church, and we could just ask you to meet me right after church out front so we can get you a job. Do you serve? Where do you serve? How are you serving? Are you ministering? Nebuchadnezzar said, who is this God? Who is this God that's going to deliver you? I would love to have been there. You know, I'd love to have said, he's the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He's the bright and morning star. He's the lily of the valley. He is the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. He is my soon coming King. And every knee is going to bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Amen. But lastly, this is the best part. The fourth man is coming. Now, did that sink in? The fourth man is coming. You know, when these Hebrew children went in the fire, God did not send one of his top angels He didn't send Clarence from It's a Wonderful Life. You know who he sent? Jesus said, I'm going myself. And Jesus came just like he did at 3 a.m. in the morning to the disciples in the boat that was sinking. When the fire came around them, Jesus was there walking through the fire with them, and the fire couldn't burn them, and the smell of smoke was not upon them, and they were not harmed because Jesus himself went with them. He said, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I'll walk through the fire with you, and I'll lead you all the way home. Amen. Praise the Lord. Look at the total victory. Look at the total victory. They were prisoners one day, and they were elevated to prime ministers the next day. Right now, the church is in the fire. I hope you realize we're in the fire. The world, academia, secular humanism, they're all wanting to destroy with political correctness, and they want to silence the church and Christians and intimidate us into being quiet, and we're in the fire. But I want to tell you, if we take a stand and we say our God is able, even though we walk through the fire, God is going to deliver us and bring a great victory into our lives. Amen. They had a cause that was greater than their own life. They had a cause that was bigger than their life. Paul said, for me to live is Christ, and to die is vain. Revelations 12, it says, they loved not their lives unto death, but they were ready to take a stand, and they overcame him by the word of their testimony and by the blood of the Lamb. And today we can win by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Folks, I want to tell you, Martin Luther King Jr. said, if a man has not found something worth dying for, he is not fit to live. Folks, have you found something worth dying for? Have you found something that is worth giving your all to? Something that is bigger than you are? Something that's greater than just your life? Paul said, I am crucified with Christ, yet I live. But it's not me, but it's Christ in me. Can we take a stand for God?